Shore here for smoothjazz.com on Smooth Travel, and I'm sitting with David Sanborn, who's joining us this time on the Smooth Jazz Cruise 2013. We're week one here.
That's right. It's great so far. I mean, I think this cruise this year is the best so far. I mean, it's certainly such a wide variety of unbelievably great music and musicians and George Benson, Bob James. We're going to do the whole Double Vision album live. Ken Ford, Candy Dulfer, Richard Elliott, Rick Braun, Brian Culbertson, all these great people, you know.
And the backup musicians as well are really incredible.
Man,
Andre Berry.
Frank Third Richardson.
Incredible drummer.
Yeah, great players. Players.
There's just not a bad musician on this ship, and I think even some of the guests are probably pretty darn good,
that's
too.
That's true. The bar is very high.
The bar is high here, and as a jazz enthusiast, if you're not a musician, it's just a ton of fun as well. We're having a good time, and we're chatting with David, and I'm going to ask him a question about the format that we call Smooth Jazz, and you've been given a lot of ink on this over the last 10 years or so.
I guess so, yeah. I mean, you know, that term kind of grew up, kind of came into being after, you know, people like me and George and Bob James and Marcus and Al Jarreau had been doing this for a long time. Earl Klug and, why am I blanking on his name? Saxophone player.
John Clemmer?
No. The two of us. Why am I blanking?
Oh, Grover.
Grover Washington. Why? Wow. Of all people to forget his name, right? I mean, and that term kind of, you know, grew up around us. So it never really, you know, it never kind of really registered with me what exactly that was.
So it kind of rubbed you wrong a little bit?
I don't know if it rubbed me wrong. It was irrelevant to what I was doing.
I see.
You know, and it, I think it came to be more of a much smaller window when it started to become a formula.
It got niched down.
Yeah, that's a very good way of putting it. Mm-hmm. To the point where, you know, people were trying to figure out, okay, what is it that made this song a hit, and let me try to figure out the formula for that. And it became something that was constructed and thought out rather than something that came honestly from the way people were feeling. And it's happened not just with jazz or smooth jazz, but with every genre, you know, with country music, certainly, you know, with alternative music, mm-hmm. or, you know, any kind of rock and roll, rhythm and blues, it just, you know, it gets marketed to death.
Well, let me propose this. I think this is what happens when the accountants get into the music.
Well, there's no question about it, you know.
And by accountants, I mean consultants, really.
Yeah, well, yeah, absolutely. You know, because they you know, well, it used to be that they would advise radio stations about, okay, this is what this is your demographic, this is what your audience wants to hear. I mean, you know this as a broadcaster for all these years.
Yeah.
And then, you get a playlist submitted to you of like, okay, these are the tunes that you need to play. And, you know, wait a minute, what about the song that I love that, that's not on the list.
Yeah, and what happened to the art of the DJ? Because that's why I got into radio.
And frankly, that's what made my career. Because there were some, you know, local radio stations, particularly in Pittsburgh and Cleveland, that broke me as an artist. And those two cities really helped create a groundswell for me to then go build in other places, you know. And, you know, the other DJs in other cities would say, hey, listen, did you hear what's happening in Cleveland? Look at this. Well, who is this guy? And blah, blah, blah. And something explodes. And there was a regional reality to it. And it was like there was a constant sense of discovery. Mm-hmm. And I think that joy of discovering something is gone.
You rarely hear the words, we broke this artist.
Yeah, no.
We made this artist, pop this artist out of the box or whatever. You don't hear that anymore.
No, unless you hear it from a large corporate entity.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, somebody who's been groomed and constructed. And you know, I mean, they can take a very potentially promising artist and squeeze all the life out of them before they even get out of the gate. So they're so scared to make a natural move that they're, you know, they got to hew to this line because they say, listen, if you want our money behind you to break you as an artist, you can do this, but more importantly, you can't do this.
More importantly.
Yeah. And then, you know, you see all these people, you know, especially in the pop world, going crazy at a certain point. They say, wait a minute, what's this image that you've constructed for me? And look, that's always existed in the music business. Always. It's always existed, but you could survive outside of that. Now, it's very hard to survive outside of that reality economically, because music is such a smaller part of people's lives anymore. People have... Music has ceased to be an engine for social change.
And this is where we're seeing the internet step up, where FM used to be. And I think this is where you'll get excited with that iPad that you have.
Absolutely. That's right. That's what people tell me.
You
this
do?
Strange device. I'm like a caveman.
You do have one. But there's so much music out there online now because of this demand. People want the art and the music. Yeah. And without blaming, you know, because we can blame. But I believe that's profound immaturity, so we won't blame. But either the consultants, the labels, and the pop machine and all that did change the landscape at radio, so radio went online.
Yeah, I think that's true. And look, I mean, this is a consumer society that we live in. I mean, and it's just, you know, it's the nature of the way it is, and things change. And this is the new reality. So you have to accept it. You can bemoan the fact that certain aspects of the old way have disappeared, but, you know, get over it.
Well, and I propose it's going to be better, actually. It's getting better now because nowadays you can discover new music. You have these apps, an application is what an app is.
That's called an app? Let me write that.
And I'm just slowly bringing Dave into the, yeah. But you can...
Unless you get an app on a computer, right?
No. We're not using computers so much anymore.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. But we'll talk about that off camera. But the app Shazam, have you heard of this?
There's an app and an app Shazam?
There's an app called Shazam.
And what happens? You punch that and
you hit it? No, and the song that's playing wherever you are.
Yeah. My that's right. My wife told me that.
Yeah.
She's like, look at this, honey. And they pointed it at the
You can buy. I mean, I'm having a burrito and Chipotle. I hear something I like. Boom. I've got the song.
I know. It's unbelievable. That's fantastic.
And that's great for you.
That's exactly right.
That's the new world.
That's it. And you know, I think the technology, you know, I think on the positive side, the technology is growing at such a rapid pace that it's exploding so fast that these big corporate entities, which move very slowly, can't get their mitts on it.
No, and there are very few of them anymore.
That's right.
Yeah. So it is kind of an independent world now, and it's getting, and those who are harnessing, you know, the lifestyle part of the technology. Yeah. Yeah. Not so much the technology. I'm not an IT person. I just love the lifestyle part of it.
Absolutely.
And that's why Steve Jobs was brilliant to make it, to put it out of our laps, really, and right into our, you know, hearts.
Got to take it out of
the
techie world.
Yeah, and on the smooth jazz front, I appreciate your viewpoint, and I completely understand what you're saying. For us, it is a brand name, and it was always used as marketing when I started in the format. Steve Feinstein, John Sebastian had a much broader concept for this genre.
Right.
It was everything from your music to Tracy Chapman to Shadowfax and everything in between, but it was very broad.
My contention is, how can you use the word jazz as a concept and not include somebody like Miles Davis? You know, and it's not that there's, I understand that, you know, mood wise you have to maintain a certain kind of, you know, sensibility, but there's certainly stuff in the Miles Davis catalog, which is vast, that fits into that whatever smooth category.
You're talking programming now, because...
Well, I'm talking programming.
Yeah, because the name doesn't really matter, and they should be playing Miles, because he actually is really a forefather of it as well.
Yeah, exactly.
And those ballads are delicious.
Absolutely. but that's essentially what I'm talking about.
Yeah.
When you use the word jazz, that denotes to me an inclusiveness.
Absolutely.
That incorporates a wide variety of music.
And you know what I'm hearing? I actually think what your exception may have been is with the programming and the narrow casting. Not so much not so much the name. And it did happen, and we did as a format get over consulted. On smoothjazz.com global radio, we 4 times a day play straight ahead, and we call it Jazz on the Half Shell.
Yeah.
And we include those tasty tracks because they belong there.
Absolutely.
They're both smooth and they're jazz.
Yeah, absolutely. And so and you know, the other music very, very often is just instrumental pop music.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, really, because, you know, part of the nature of what jazz is a certain kind of improvise, a certain kind of freedom. Mm-hmm. And a lot of what that music that's, you know, called smooth jazz is instrumental pop music, and there's nothing wrong with that.
No. And where your situation is different, you bring jazz sensibilities to melody, really. You have very melodic music, but it's jazz sensibilities, which is why you're such a respected cat.
Well, a cat, man. Well, I came out of that world.
Yeah.
You know, that's the world that I come from. So it's, you know, it's not something that I really am conscious of.
It's just
something that I do.
It is accessible, though.
Well, absolutely. I think it is.
And I pay you a compliment saying that.
No, I take it as a compliment.
Yeah.
I don't think that inaccessibility is a mark of artistic excellence.
It's not.
You know,
no. The fact that so many people can, you know, grab onto your music at all levels of depth, you know, from the person that just likes a really good melody to the person that hears your tone, you know,
right,
and the notes you choose and don't choose.
Right.
You know? So. You know, it's interesting. I love having this conversation with you.
Likewise.
Yeah, we're talking about the format of smooth jazz, contemporary jazz. Originally, in radio, it was called New Adult Contemporary, which probably really what it was.
Well,
pop instrumental.
Well, you remember a concept called the Quiet Storm?
Oh, yeah, totally.
That was the other one.
Yeah,
that,
urban,
you know,
leaning.
Yeah, or yeah, exactly.
And, you know, a lot of those artists have an exception with the term urban.
Yeah.
Because it implies, you know, lower income.
Yeah, well, exactly. And quite frankly, that's the way record companies thought of it as marketing.
They did. Yeah. And, you know, my theory and our theory, I guess, is that a rose by any other name, you know, that's our theory, that we have the brand name Smooth Jazz, so that's cool. People can find us.
Yes.
But we're deep. And instead of 400 songs, we're at 4,000 songs.
Yeah, well, you know, I think you can imbue that term with more meaning. And make it more meaningful. I mean, I have no objection to the term because it's a destination. It's a place for people to find something. Okay, you know.
Right. And honestly, if maybe this had been on FM and you had heard that, and you'd heard several of your album cuts, not just your hits, you might have been more impressed with the name back then.
Yeah. Well, exactly.
It wouldn't have bothered you, maybe.
Well, but it, you know, the way it came at me is I got all kinds of grief from every possible aspect.
Yeah,
from the jazz, you know, from the straight ahead jazz community, they lost their minds.
They
completely lost their minds. Yeah. What are you doing? You know, okay, hey, come on, man.
You got sucked up into it, didn't you?
I'm just, in that controversy, and I'm, you know, I just do what I do.
Yeah.
You know, I don't.
People categorize.
Yeah, and go ahead.
Yeah.
You know, if that's what you, how you want to spend your time, more power to you, you know.
You know, it you know, if you get played, you get played, and I think that's really, you know, how people love to do what they do. So, but the world has changed, and technology has helped us get the art out there, and I feel like in just the last 12 years with smoothjazz.com, we've introduced this music to countries that never even knew what contemporary jazz was, you know?
And I think that's important.
And I think we've defined it respectfully. We've always tried to take the name, you know, and be respectful with the format to the artists and the fans and keep it accessible and deep.
Yeah, exactly.
No, new jazz, no rules.
That's it. I love that. That's the deal.
That's it. Thanks for your time.
Thanks, Sandy.
We'll talk again.
Okay.
Okay, Sandy Shore for smoothjazz.com. Thanks.